Hello everyone, welcome to the first installment of the medical school application guide video series. Today I'll be giving you a very visual timeline overview of the medical school application process. This is for anyone and everyone who's interested in pursuing medicine, whether you're a first year college student, a high school student starting early, a pre-med, someone who's applying this cycle, this video is for you. Just wanted to give a quick disclaimer. I'm a traditional applicant. I took one gap year. I only applied to US MD schools, so no DO schools. And I only use AMCAS, so I didn't use TMDSAS, which is for Texas schools. And to briefly reintroduce myself, hi, I'm May. I graduated from Brown in 2021 with a bachelor's in public health, and I will be matriculating to medical school this fall. Super excited, and let's just get into it. So I made this ideal medical school application timeline with some key important dates at the top and then a timeline of the year. If you find timelines online, most of the time they'll have these date ranges very extended, and I don't think that's ideal because the more you extend these time windows, so if you submit your essays later, that affects the likelihood that you will receive an interview invite at schools that interview on a rolling basis, which is pretty much every medical school. We'll talk about why it's important to submit early on later in the video, but let's talk about the application timeline. So the first question you might be asking, which I might dedicate a whole video to, is when should I take the MCAT? As you can see in this diagram below, you can take the MCAT anytime up until the spring of your application cycle and you'll be fine. I took the MCAT the September of my senior year and then applied the summer after my senior year ended. You want to make sure that your MCAT does not expire if you want to reapply, but you don't want to take your MCAT so close to the application opening that you have delays in your application being processed by medical schools. At Brown, we have something called the HCAD, which is the preliminary form of our application that we fill out for our health careers office. So I began drafting my primary back in around February before the application opened. I would say just leading up to May, start thinking and brainstorming about what you want to write about in your personal statement. The vast majority of my actual revising happened in the month of May. So I would say beginning of May, when the application opens, that's when you really should hunker down and ask people for help with revising your essay. To look at the important dates at the top of the timeline, your AMCAS opens, which is your primary application with like your activities, your experiences, etc. That application opens at the beginning of May, typically in like the first week of May. And then your primary application can be submitted at the end of May, so May 31st for this cycle. Definitely submit as early as you can so that you can receive secondaries from medical schools as early as possible. And then at the end of June, around the 24th this year, that is the first date that your process primaries can be sent to medical schools, and therefore secondaries will roll out soon after. So again, your primary application is your work and activities, your biographical information, your letters of recommendation, which can be sent later on, so you can submit your primary without your letters of recommendation, and your personal statement, which you get 5,300 characters to write about anything you want, but really this is a space for you to answer why you want to go to medical school, why you're pursuing medicine, along those lines. I think you should submit your primary ideally before mid-June. I would say, again, as early as possible without sacrificing quality of your essay. You'll never have a perfect essay, but once you feel like you've done sufficient revision to where you think it's polished and communicates the main reasons for why you want to pursue medicine, it's good for submission. Another standardized test that you might have to take in purple is the CASPer, which is now called the Altus Suite. Not every school requires the other stuff in the Altus Suite, but some of them require the CASPer, which is kind of a behavioral test where you have free response questions about sort of ethical, moral scenarios. They just want to make sure you're an empathetic human being. And the situational judgment test, which is required by, I think, even less schools. I think UC Davis was the only school that I applied to that required the situational judgment test. Very similar in concept to the CASPer, only that it's provided by the AMC and it's multiple choice instead of free response. I believe I took one in June and then the other in July. looking back, I was definitely way too stressed about it. It's not that important in the grand scheme of things. I don't think it's something that will make or break your application. I think you really only need like a week to prepare for each of these. But I would just get it out of the way in between May to like August, but they have dates up until the following April for you to take the CASPer. After you submit your primary application, you're eventually going to get secondaries from schools. So your primary application gets sent to all medical schools, but medical schools will also have secondary essays that are specific to that school. This is really similar to supplemental essays from college applications. You're going to be most likely applying to way more medical schools than you did for colleges. So most people apply from anywhere between 16 to like 30 schools. I ended up applying to 33 or 34. Would not recommend. I would say max apply to 30 for it to be manageable to write all these secondaries. A lot of them are repeated, and I will make a separate video talking about sort of common secondary essays, but you definitely want to pre-write those main secondaries that are common across schools. The ones that come to mind are the diversity essay, so what diversity will you bring to the school, adversity or challenge that you have faced and how you overcame it. Similar to adversity and challenge essays, you have a mistake that you made and what you learned from it or how you overcame it. And if you're taking a gap year, definitely pre-write your gap year essay. Then when you actually are going to submit your secondaries, you just have to tailor your essays to the word count for each school, and that will really accelerate the process. I received my first secondary on June 25th and submitted my last secondary, I think, in early August. If you submitted your primary application in like the first or second week of June, you're probably going to get a huge wave of secondaries in July that can feel really overwhelming. A general rule of thumb that is common for applicants is to submit a secondary 2 weeks after you receive it. If you're pressed to prioritize which schools to complete secondaries first for, I would prioritize the ones that maybe are easier to write or the ones that are more important to you. So which schools do you care more about? Which schools really clearly prioritize rolling admissions? For example, University of Michigan publishes data on how people who submit their application earlier are the bulk of the people who receive interview invites, while other schools might claim that their admissions are not on a rolling basis. In terms of when you can expect most interviews to be sent out, I received the bulk of my interview invites before winter break. I think I only received one or two interview invites in January. If you have not received any interview invites by the end of November, so around Thanksgiving break, that is when you should probably prepare to reapply. Even if you do receive one or two interviews after November break, you don't really want to hedge your bets on just those schools. And to come back to letters of recommendations, ask for your letters of recommendations early on. I actually applied for a research fellowship the summer before the application cycle, so 1 year before, and so I had solicited letters of recommendation from a lot of the professors that I would later ask for med school letters of rec. Another example of asking early on is, for instance, if you did a summer internship in the summer of your sophomore year, which is what I did. I asked my research mentor to provide me a letter of recommendation right after I had finished that internship. He held on to that, and then when I applied, I asked him to revise that letter of recommendation. So if you've taken a class or you had a research experience where you know you want to ask that person for a letter of rec, have them write it when that experience is still fresh. That way they have a lot of examples to provide in your letter of recommendation. They can hold on to it, or you can use Interfolio, I believe, which is a letter of recommendation holding site. And then they can submit it on your behalf when you're actually applying a year or two down the line. So takeaway for letters of recommendation, there's no perfect time to ask, but earlier is always better in my opinion. And make sure to stay in constant communication, give reminders. People are really busy, so always check in advance so that you don't get in a situation where they have to cram the letter of recommendation when the deadline is. So let's talk about the importance of submitting your application early. This is a graph of AMCAS verification times in the 2019 to 2020 cycle. As you can see here, if you submit your application in the end of May or early June, right when you first are allowed to, your processing time for your application is going to be a lot shorter than if you wait until when most people are submitting, which is going to be in later June and early July. Essentially, when you submit your primary application, it has to be processed, and so you're going to put all of your courses and your grades, and someone has to verify that you actually got those grades in those classes based off of your transcripts. Going back to that previous application timeline, remember that June 24th is the first date that process primaries can be sent to medical schools. You want your application to be sent right on that date of June 24th, and so you want your application to be processed by that date so that you can be in that first batch of applicants that is receiving secondaries. As an extreme, right, if you submit your application, let's say in August, sure, you're gonna have a short processing time. However, a lot of those first batch applicants will have already received their secondaries, interview invites will have started going out already, and so you have a slightly decreased chance of receiving interview invite just because those interview invites have started going out already. Here is another graph. This is from the AMC, which shows AMCAS verification for various application years, so 2018 to 2020. Just want to show there's the same kind of trend where if you submit early on in June, you have a shorter verification time for your application. You don't want to wait until July or August. And finally, I wanted to share a histogram of my personal secondary turnaround time. So again, I applied to, I think, 33 schools, but I believe I only completed 32 of those secondaries. I had a average secondary turnaround time of 12.6 days and a median of 14 days. So I tried my best really to stick to that 2-week rule. But as you can see here, there were some applications where I took up to like 30 days to turn back, others that were really fast because maybe they only had one or two essays that I already pre-wrote that I spent less than, you know, 5 days on. But the bulk of them I was able to complete within that 2-week time frame. To talk briefly about what happens after you're done interviewing, it's a really by school basis situation in terms of how long you should expect to wait before hearing back from schools. Usually for rolling admission schools, they'll tell you when to expect a decision. For instance, for a lot of UC schools, they'll tell you you'll receive a decision 4 weeks or 6 weeks after you interview. On the other hand, I've definitely had experiences where I interviewed at a rolling admission school and I didn't hear back until like 5 months later. So it's really unpredictable. Don't think too much into it. Speaking to that last example, some schools will be like partially rolling and partially not rolling. And then there are schools that are very clearly not rolling, and so they'll give all of their decisions on the same day. So this would be like Mayo, this would be a lot of Ivy League schools. They'll say that they're going to give all their decisions in, let's say, February or March. But really, again, don't think way too much into it. Just kind of do your best in the moment and focus on the things that you can control. While I'm making this video to give you an overview to kind of know what to expect in the overall process, when you're actually in the application cycle, take everything a day at a time or a week at a time. Focus on, for instance, when you're working on primaries, just focus on doing your primaries. Don't worry about your secondaries. When you start receiving your secondaries, focus on your secondaries and don't worry about interviewing. So whenever you're in each phase of this timeline, just focus on what you're doing at that moment. Don't worry too much about what comes next. I think that's probably my biggest advice to get through the application cycle and staying relatively okay. All right, I hope you found this video helpful, and I'll see you next time.